In this video, we will discuss a very powerful technique called dimensional verification in engineering, which allows us to verify if a given formula or equation is dimensionally consistent or not. So remember, in a formula or an equation, you have two sides, left-hand side and the right-hand side of equal to sign. And we want to ensure that the two sides have the same dimension. Otherwise, you're not comparing apples to apples. So the technique is called dimensional verification. So we'll start with a simple example. All of you know this famous formula from Einstein called E equals mc squared. We know that E on the left-hand side is energy, and the right-hand side m is the mass, and c is the speed of light, right? So we know basically what these physical quantities are. We also have an idea as to what their dimensions are and what their units are. So if this formula is to be dimensionally consistent, then the dimension of the energy on the left-hand side should be same as the dimension of energy on the right side. So mc squared should reduce to the dimension of energy. So what we will do is we will reduce the dimensions of all these quantities into the base dimensions. Okay, so now when it comes to the left side, the E, we can use any expression for energy. It could be kinetic energy, it could be potential energy due to gravity or due to spring forces or anything like that. Any expression of energy that you can remember, you can use that. So let's say we use E equal to 1/2 mv square as the expression for kinetic energy. Okay, now remember, E is actually not equal to 1/2 mv squared. We are using it just to get the dimension of energy. So what are the dimensions of half? Well, that's a dimensionless quantity, so we don't worry about that. What about the m? So dimension, let me write it, dimensions of E is equal to m, which is the dimension of the mass, times velocity. Velocity is distance over time, right? So that would be L over t to the power 2. So dimensions are m times l to the power 2 times t power minus 2. So in terms of the base dimensions, m, l, t, and if you also have temperature, then you can use theta. If you have current, you can use I as a symbol for that. We use the basic symbol to write the dimension. Notice that I'm not actually using the units because the units are dependent on which system you pick. So it's a little bit messy using the units. So, all right, now let's look at the dimensions of mc squared. So what are the dimensions of mc squared? Well, that would be m. C is, of course, L over T, because that's the speed. So that would be that. So ML square T power minus 2, which is same as, you know, what you obtained before. So this is saying that this formula is dimensionally consistent. Okay. Now, the dimensional verification technique will not basically give you anything that's behind the physics behind the system. Okay. So if there was a half over here or a one third or something else, the dimensional verification technique will not give you that dependence. It will only tell you whether the formula is dimensionally correct or not. Let's look at another example. This is example of, let's say we want to compute the frequency of a pendulum. Okay, so it has a certain length and it is maybe operating in some sort of gravitational environment where the acceleration due to gravity is g. So given this pendulum, which has a length of L, and let's say we also have a mass m operating in a gravitational environment, we want to find out what is a general formula for frequency if we think that frequency depends on some of these parameters. Okay, we don't know whether frequency is equal to L times G or L times G over M. We don't know any of that stuff. Okay, so what we assume is that there are certain powers of each of these quantities. So let's say L to the power A. Okay, so if A is 1, we'll know it's directly proportional. If A is 2, it'll be L squared. If A is, let's say, minus 1/2, it'll be 1 over square root of that, right? And then G to the power B, and again, B is also an unknown. And let's say there is some dependence on the mass also, which we don't know whether there is any or not, but let's assume that there is a dependence on mass as well. So the M to the power C, you know, if you want, you can also add temperature, let's say T to the power D, okay? So each of these four powers over here, A, B, C, and D, are unknown to us, and we want to find them, okay? Now, using the dimensional verification technique, we can find out what these powers are, okay, what these exponents are. All we have to do is write the dimensions of the quantities on the left side and the right side, okay? So what do we have on the left side? We have, so dimensions of F. What are the dimensions of F? F is frequency, which is 1 over time period, so that would be T power minus 1. Okay, dimensions of the right side. So dimensions of L to the power A, G to the power B, M to the power C, theta power D, which is what we want to write, would be L to the power A, because that's the length, g is gravitational acceleration, and gravitational acceleration is defined as average velocity over time. Velocity is L over 2, so this will be L over t squared to the power b, and then we have m to the power c, which is a base dimension, and theta is also a base dimension, so we write that. Okay, now let's collect all the like terms. So L to the power a plus b times t power minus 2b times m to the power c times theta power d. Okay, so that's the dimension of the right side. Now, if this formula over here is dimensionally consistent, then this dimension should match with the dimension over here. So let's write that. So t power minus 1 should be equal to L to the power a plus b, t power minus 2b, m to the power c, and theta power d. Okay. Now, we don't have any terms of m, l, theta on the left-hand side, so we can write this as m to the power 0, l to the power 0, and theta power 0. Okay? Now, let's compare it. So, a plus b should be equal to 0. So, let's write that. A plus b should be equal to 0. So, that tells you that a should be equal to minus b. Then, let's compare the powers of t. So, minus 2b should be equal to minus 1. So, that gives you b equal to 1 over 2. And if you substitute this over here, you get a equal to minus 1 over 2, right? Okay. Now, c should be equal to 0 by comparison. So, c is 0. And similarly, d should be equal to 0 by comparison. So, that's 0. So, that gives us f equal to, let's substitute a, b, c, d back in this formula over here. So, the l to the power a, so that would be l to the power minus 1 half. G to the power b, that's g to the power 1 half. And m to the power 0 would be 1. And theta to the power 0 would be 1. So, we are left with only square root of g over l, and that's what we get. Okay, now that's not the actual formula for the frequency of a pendulum. You know, it's actually f equal to 1 over 2 pi times square root of g over l. So you really don't get 1 half from this, because you're not really doing the physics over here. You are using a dimensional verification technique to find out what the general dependence of gravity and length is on the frequency. But it does tell you quite a bit. It at least tells you that there is no dependence on the mass of the pendulum, and there's no dependence on the temperature either over here. Okay? All right, let's do another example. This is the example of a cantilever. So we have a cantilever. Cantilever is basically a rod, all right, that's inserted inside, let's say, a wall. It could be, you know, bolted, it could be riveted, it could be screwed, it doesn't really matter, okay? And let's say this rod has a length L, has a diameter D, okay? And what you are going to do is you would apply a force at the tip of it. So as a result of applying this force, you would have this rod deflect slightly, okay? So it's going to bend. Now this bend may not be appreciable depending on the length of the rod, okay? So this is going to basically bend. So now the question is, if let's say this deflection of the tip point is delta x, okay, then knowing something about the property of the material, the length, the diameter, as well as the force, can you find out what the delta x is, what the deflection would be? So when you take engineering mechanics class, let's solid mechanics, let me say 363 over here, then you will learn that delta x is given by this formula. So delta x is equal to 64 f times l cubed divided by 3 pi e to times d power 4. Okay, so that's the formula. Now over here, f is the force, l is the length, e is the elasticity modulus or the Young's modulus, and d is the diameter. Okay, so we have to know something about what elasticity modulus looks like so that we can write its dimension. Given this formula, now the question is, can you verify whether this is dimensionally consistent or not? Okay, that's what we're trying to do. So we already know the dimension of delta x. Dimension of delta x would be length. Let's find out the dimensions of each of these quantities on the right side. Let's first write the dimension of E. So dimension of E, which is the elasticity or the Young's modulus, is actually force divided by area. So this would be simply force over L squared. And I'll leave the force over here because I have the force expression in the numerator, and this force would be in the denominator, so they would cancel out. So I'll just leave the F over here. But if I wanted, I could write in terms of mass times acceleration. So since we know that force is mass times acceleration, that would be mass times acceleration is L over T squared, right, divided by L squared. Okay, so you could write that, but it's not necessary over here. Now let's write the dimension of the right side, 64 times F times L cubed over 3 pi E d to the power 4. So this entire expression. So 64 and 3 over here, of course, they don't matter because they're numbers. So we have f times l cube divided by e is f over l square, and d is l, so that's l to the power 4. F cancels, so we get what? This becomes l to the power 2, so l cube over l square, and that's equal to l, which is same as the dimension on the left-hand side, right? So this tells you that at least the formula is dimensionally consistent. If I change this to, let's say, l to the power 4, you know that this would not check out, right? Because this would become l square on the right side, while this would be simply l, and the two would not match. So that's the power of dimension verification. You can verify if a formula is dimensionally consistent.